What needs to be different this year compared to last year to win it, to get to the Super Bowl, take that next step, and just to keep getting better? What do you guys, how do you close the gap?
Well, I mean, I think in terms of just, you know, offensively speaking, I thought we were really young last year. You know, we were young last year, and we're young again this year, but I think the difference is we're experienced now. I mean, I was a rookie, and I played in 17 games last season on a team that was the best team in the NFL for 16 weeks straight.
Yeah.
But it was, for me, it was eye-opening experience, because once we got to the playoffs, you know, really anybody can win. It doesn't matter where you're the first seed, sixth seed. It doesn't matter about any of that stuff. The thing that really takes over at that point is, you know, just having experience.
Yeah.
And, you know, obviously playing in the playoffs, like I said, my rookie year, you know, we have that experience in our back pocket. I mean, it's only my second year, but I'm expected to act like a veteran now. Like, how is this his second year? He's expected to act like a veteran now.
Yeah.
And I think that's the mentality that this offense has kind of taken over. We're young, but we're not inexperienced anymore.
Miles, can you imagine? Think about this, though. You, in so many ways, I mean, the timing is serendipitous, man. If you're a rookie this year instead of last year, I mean, I know you're a smart kid, Notre Dame stock. They don't let anybody in there. I get it. So you probably would have adapted nicely, like Tiki would have as well. But imagine jumping into the season this year as a rookie with COVID and Zooms. And I mean, man, oh, man, these rookies must be swimming.
Yeah, it's tough on these guys. I mean, we got a great group of rookies, too. But, I mean, it's tough on them at first, especially during camp, because you just get thrown in right with the vets from day one. There was no OTAs, no mini camp. So, no, but I think they've been handling it well, especially our rookies. They went out there, made some plays on Sunday. And, yeah, no, it's definitely the circumstances change things a lot. But, you know, I think we're just grateful that we're all playing right now.
Yeah, it makes it easy when you have a coaching staff that is good as your coaching staff is. And it also helps when you have a quarterback like Lamar Jackson. Now, we know that he's a video game. We're talking about Madden 21. He's a video game out on the field. But the question I have for you as a wide receiver, I mean, you caught with three passes last week. I know you had four targets. It's not like you guys don't throw the ball. 25 attempts Lamar had last week, 20 and 25 he was as well. So he's getting better in that regard. At least that's the criticism that people want to throw at him. But more importantly, as a receiver, in order to make some of these big plays happen, you got to be aware of what he's doing. Like, how aware do you have to be downfield? I'm talking, obviously, not catching the ball, but blocking for him.
No, just everything you do. I mean, it's kind of crazy because I've been on plays where I'm on the backside of the play and he's running to the front side of the field. Next thing I know, he's all the way back by me, running on my sideline. And, you know, I just got to hold that block just because he's so dynamic. You never know where he's going to be, which is a great thing. I mean, having Lamar out there, another thing, you never know when the ball is going. Like I said, I've been on the back side of a play on a pass play, and he's rolling out. Next thing I know, he's hitting me, you know, on the back side. So it's just like, it's crazy the things that he can do. His vision is amazing. And I've never played with a quarterback like that, obviously, but when you got a quarterback like him who breaks all the traditional rules of being a quarterback because he's so dynamic, you have to break the rules of being a receiver at times. Just because you know if you get open, he's going to find a way to get you the ball.
And you got to break the rules of how you coach him. You got to let the horse run out of the stable, man. You can't keep him locked up.
Exactly.
You know?
Our coaching staff does a great job with that.
They do. We're talking to Miles Boykin, great coaching staff. What is he, you know, I remember meeting him when he won the Heisman. Reserved, very quiet, very humble, very classy young man. How has he grown in the huddle? What is his voice like? Not in front of cameras, not around us, but in the locker room from a leadership point of view, in the huddle on an important drive. Take us inside, you know, what he's like as you stand right next to him as you get ready for him to call play.
He's just a true leader. He's demanding in the huddle. I mean, like I said, he's just a true leader. And, you know, every time we step on that field, he expects greatness out of everybody that's around him. And that's what makes a great quarterback. You know, if we're all great, then the team is great. And, you know, I think that's just something that, you know, every time I try to step out on that field, you know, my job is to go out there and make things as easy as possible on him. And his mindset is, you know, my job is to make things as easy as possible for everybody else on the field. So we all have that mindset. We're all working together as a team. And, you know, that's how you reach team goals.
Will he chew a guy out if he has to?
I don't know if he'd chew a guy out necessarily, but he'll tell him. He's not, like, that's probably one of my other favorite things about him. Like, he's not going to, you know, try to belittle you in front of other people. He's going to say, hey, listen, like, you got to do this or that. Or, you know, how can I help you do this or that? You know, that's the type of person he is. So, you know, you know, whenever, you know, he's talking to you, it's coming from the heart. It's not coming from a place of, you know, he's mad at you or anything like that.
Gotcha.
You know, I want to win. We got to do the right thing.
Yeah. Got it.
You know, Miles, you mentioned something that was very interesting. Lamar Jackson breaks quarterback rules. So as a receiver, you have to break wide receiver rules. And I know this from being in the NFL. Not all plays are clean. It's not like, hey, we drew it up like this. It's going to come out like it doesn't. And all of a sudden, there's a scramble going on. Do you guys have like scramble rules? Like what happens when, you know, 1-2-3 read is not there and Lamar all of a sudden pulls the ball down? You're thinking he's running, but he's actually throwing. What are you guys taught to do in order to stay viable for Lamar downfield? Because he will fire it in somewhere when no one expects it.
Right. Well, I mean, I think the biggest thing for us is really just get open, you know, like common sense. Like obviously he's rolling out right. Don't run away from him and run left. You know,
yeah.
Things, just simple things like that. If you get open in his line of vision, he's going to find you. And that's why I said you have to break the rules of being a receiver because, you know, there's not quarterbacks in the league that can do what Lamar can do. Lamar will make four people miss in the backfield and throw a dart downfield. Like quarterbacks, you know, a lot of quarterbacks can't do that.
Yeah.
So we have to be prepared for that and just play till the whistle's blown, truly.
I was going to ask you about
your offensive coordinator, Greg Roman, who obviously was with Colin Kaepernick, and Colin Kaepernick was similar. I think Lamar is a significantly better athlete than Cap was. But as he installs, as he puts, you know, plays together, you know, how does he install what you guys do? Because it's so unconventional from what I'm used to seeing in the National Football League.
Well, I know our blocking schemes are different in terms of, like, you know, how the O-line blocks, how the fullback blocks and mm-hmm. running backs block. But as a receiver, I mean, he makes it simple. You know, there's a reason why I don't know any of that stuff. It just makes it complicated for me.
Yeah, you don't need to know it, right?
Right, exactly. But, I mean, he makes it really simple in terms of do your job and everything will work out. So I know if I got to stay on the corner for a play, it doesn't matter if I'm on the corner for 10 seconds or 3 seconds. You know, if it's 10 seconds, usually it's a good play, but – I just know that that's my assignment. If I got to be on the safety, that's my assignment. If I got to be on the backer, that's my assignment. And, you know, that's how he kind of installs things. Like, everybody has their job. Get your job done. And if 11 people get their job done, then we're going to have positive plays.
We're talking to Miles Boykin. Probably last thing for me. Are you the kind of guy who stays up and watches the Steelers and watches that game and gets a sense of what they are in 2020? Or are you just, I'm not playing. I don't have to work. I'm going to decompress a little bit. Did you watch?
No, I definitely watched. But, I mean, it's so hard watching football. Obviously, you know,
yep.
once you're in the league, it's so hard to watch it and not criticize it like it's tape. It's hard to watch football for fun. So I watched the first half, and then I kind of let my mind take a break.
Yeah.
That defense is pretty stout, man. That defense pretty good, Miles.
Yeah, but they were good last year, too.
I think they're better this year.
Even though their offense wasn't
as
great.
So are we.
Yeah,
that's true.
Right. That's
not
true.
Saying you're not.
You know, it's Miles. It's funny you say that because I'm the same way. I actually became not a fan. When I became an NFL player, I was a fan before I was an NFL player. Once I became an NFL player, I wasn't a fan anymore. It's you'll understand what I'm talking about years from now. Last question for me: Notre Dame's in the ACC. Mm. Well, obviously, they play in the ACC, but they're actually in the ACC this year. What do you think about your alma mater's chances, one of winning the ACC, but also this unconventional college football season? You know, what does it look like to you?
Man, I got a couple of things to say about that. First of all, I'm happy they're playing football. I'm happy to play football because I love watching them play. But second of all, man, I'm so tired of taking crap from everybody saying, "Well, Notre Dame needs to join a conference. Notre Dame needs to do that." How does our schedule get easier when we join a conference? I don't get that. You know, if they take care of business, we should be in the ACC championship. Obviously, Clemson's a tough team.
Yeah,
I know we play them, but. I think they're taking the best two teams overall record.
They are.
That's right.
So then, you know, I think Notre Dame has, you know, one of the best chances to play in the ACC championship. So, I'm definitely excited to see that, though. But, I mean, at the same time, you know, I talked to a couple guys there, and they're excited to play for a conference championship. That's something that, you know, Notre Dame has never been able to do, obviously. So, I think it's going to be cool. It's cool watching them play. I watched them play Duke last week. You know, they got off to a rough start, but, you know, they
It was the first game.
Notre Dame fashion.
That's true.
Hey, don't slip up against North Carolina. I did their game last weekend. Their quarterback, Sam Howell, is pretty good. But that's the second-to-last game. So you have some time to worry about North Carolina. And then Miami at the end.
Oh, yeah. Trust me, they better take care of business, because I'm going to be upset if they don't. It's going to make everybody say, oh, that's why Notre Dame don't play in the conference.
Exactly.
Thanks for watching. Make sure you like and subscribe, and don't forget to hit that bell to be notified when we drop fresh content.